Hi everyone. What better place to start what we're going to be looking at than trying to figure out a definition of educational technology? Now, why do we even bother with that? I guarantee that most of you who are in this profession, one time or another, are going to be at a cocktail party, you're going to be talking to colleagues after school, you'll be in an elevator and somebody's going to say, what do you do? And you'll say, well, I'm in educational technology. And they'll say, oh, yeah, what's that? Computers and internet and stuff? And sometimes you'll just be tired and you'll go, yeah, that's about it. But you know that it's different than that. It's richer than that. And there's more to it going on. And in fact, people have struggled with a definition of educational technology for a long, long time in our profession. Our profession isn't that old. And so, it's not surprising that some of those definitions and some of the ideas are still kind of maturing as we go along. But let's have a look at a few of those. Let's start out with technology itself. The Greek root is techne. And in Greece, that meant a combination of art and craft and skill. It was kind of like that. It had the artistic side and had the skill side kind of messed up in it. So for people like Aristotle, it was the systematic use of technology for intelligent human action. And that's kind of a nice definition for technology. It's a very old one, but it seems to have held a lot of water for a long time. So it was really the name for the activities and the skills of the craftsperson. And the arts of the mind, of the fine arts. So we've got that craft and arts and the fine arts mixed in with it. And I think that's something that's sometimes lost in the way we approach technology, is people forget that we just aren't a bunch of technicians trying to figure out how to fit things together and what button to push, but we have a really strong sensitivity and alliance with the fine arts. Now, let me give you an example. There are at least two kinds. I like to divide technology into soft technologies and hard technologies, just for convenience more than anything else, and because most people never think of soft technologies as technology. So just for example, one type of technology, I mean, if we're talking about the way things work and kind of a creative artistic flair on it with innovation and all those kinds of things, think about it. You can have soft technologies that are approaches to doing things that don't have a whole lot to do with hard technologies or the equipment that's used. So let's think about that for a minute. Go all the way back to the Middle Ages. One perfect example of a soft technology is the three-field system of crop rotation. Okay, how do you do that? How do you make things work well and be more productive with land? And so that came about in Western Europe in the Middle Ages. We saw with three-field systems of crop rotation where you remove and rest different areas. We saw increased productivity and a variety of crops. We saw improved nutrition. We saw more natural carbohydrates and proteins. And it resulted in, it had unexpected or expanded effects. Like it resulted in rapid growth in population. People ate better, they felt better, families grew. We saw the outreach of commerce and a new exuberance of spirit that seemed to enliven the entire age. Now, it wasn't just the three-field system of crop rotation doing that, but other things came along with that too that were soft technologies, things that we did and applied in particular ways that had unforeseen consequences. And we see that today, don't we? Well, let's have another example. How about a division of labor? When division of labor came in as a system, it moved the individual responsibility for manufacturing to each person performing a few operations. So you didn't have every one craftsperson building an entire thing. You broke up the systems and skills necessary to put together a large complex system, gave those to individual people, and you had that division of labor that increased productivity again. You had a technological focus on improvement of skills and the organization of work, and not so much on tools and machinery. Okay? It wasn't just tools and machinery going on here. It was the way people were organized to accomplish certain kinds of things. So, currently, by the way, interestingly enough, we're interested in moving back, aren't we, into a more holistic approach to production. And we see that movement alive and well just all around us. But if you start thinking about soft technologies and expand it to a more modern kinds of things, you could think about online shopping and payment. You could think about how the music and video industries through streaming architectures and new business models have completely revolutionized how consumers acquire and consume video, music, do their shopping, all those kinds of things. Well, these are complex technologies around this that go far beyond the equipment involved and even far beyond the software involved. It's a radical departure. It's a disruptive departure from where we are now or where we were just a few years ago to where we are now and where we might go in society and how we organize many of our activities. You can think similarly about sign language, something as simple as cold smoking cheese and meat, or even stand-up comedy. And I'll leave that one with you to think about how might those be thought of as soft technologies, systematic or systemic approaches to accomplishing things. Well, a contemporary definition of educational technology, and by contemporary I just mean in the last, 50, 100 years, really, comparing to Aristotle. But we're looking at Gendron, who said that technology is any systematized, practical knowledge based on experimentation and scientific theory or scientific theory that enhances the capacity of society to produce goods and services and which is embodied in productive skills, organization, or machinery. Now, I was just looking at stand-up comedy as a technology, as a soft technology. Think about this definition. How does it plug in? Does that make any sense at all? Well, I think it does, and I can argue for it, but I won't. I'll leave that with you to think about. So when we move from technology to educational technology, then, it could be the educational application of technology, couldn't it? Or the infusion or adoption of technology or leveraging technology for education. So over the years, people have argued about different definitions and they've evolved quite a bit. And I'll just share a few of those with you. Lumsdaine, 1964, long time ago, a year after John Kennedy was killed, came up with two aspects of educational technology. He said one is a hardware or product orientation, and another is a software or process orientation to solve educational problems. So you have the educational problematic, and then you have, are we going to throw equipment at it and products at it, or are we going to throw software or processes at it? That's an interesting discrimination between the two, and you'll see that it's survived even to today in many aspects, in many respects. All right, then Hockridge and Romoszowski. Now Alex Romoszowski worked with Bell Labs of all places, but they said, Lumsdaine, he had a lot going for him with that definition, but they said that the philosophical assumptions that guide research and practice have to reside outside the hardware and software components. Now think about that for a minute. You have hardware, you have software. Those are fairly inert. They don't move in and of themselves, but we do have philosophical assumptions that do drive the application of those things, about where those things arrive and how those things are used and why they're employed in different places. And think about that even today. We have, of course, liberal access to the internet and streaming technologies. We're starting to get better bandwidth in a lot of areas where we can take better advantage of those kinds of things. But how those are used in classrooms, how those disrupt schools, how those are allowed to influence how learning takes place in classrooms, let's say, are very much philosophically guided, aren't they? It's not that we don't have the tools available to us to do things. It's, do we have the will? Do we have the inclination to make the kinds of changes that are suggested in many cases by the educational technologies we have available to us? It's a very different kind of problematic. Ivor Davies. Now, Ivor Davies was a former professor of mine a long time ago, and a great professor, by the way. Wonderful. This is my homage to Ivor Davies. Wonderful, wonderful person. Excellent in instructional design. But anyway, his definition said, he said in 1971, he had a definition that basically said that educational technology is a conceptual framework able to deal with problems stemming from the needs of an education or training system to survive, grow, and develop the capacity to adapt and manage change. Now, he's a very clever guy, and look at the way he used language. He's using language like capacity to adapt and manage change. He's talking about that problem, or that problematic again. And so he's just not talking about training systems that do something. He's talking about them surviving, growing, and developing capacity. That's a very, very different orientation. And we see the capacity issue coming up time and time again, even in contemporary uses of educational technology, and by contemporary now, or modern uses, or new uses, or emerging uses. We see this coming up time and time again, don't we? How we define the problems often defines how we employ the technologies, and how we use those technologies often depends on what our capacity happens to be. We might have grand ideas on how we could do all kinds of things, let's say, in schools now, but are they limited by the bandwidth available in schools? I'd say yes. You know, there many times there are. So the capacity isn't the systemic capacity in that case may not be available to us to look after what we want to do. Now, in 1978, Davies came in again and said, you know, I forgot something. I want to add criticism and evaluation with a problem-solving approach. Now, he was very much into problem-solving at the time. And the whole criticism and evaluation piece is a stronger incorporation of instructional design into the kinds of things that might be employed in a new definition of educational technology. Well, Pals and Plomp, 1989, they came along and they said, you know, let's divide it into three different things. This is almost going back to that Lumsdaine first definition from 1964, but expanding it. And they said, well, let's call educational technology one, physical media, okay? Educational technology two, we'll talk about processes used for developing, designing, and evaluating instruction. Then educational technology three, there's that philosophical and holistic piece that they were criticized by Romaszewski and others for not having in the first place, or Lumsdaine was. So Pals and Plomp kind of took that conversation, modernized it, and came up with this threefold definition. Now, that's not so helpful when you're at a cocktail party, because if somebody says, what do? And you say, well, the definition of educational technology, there are really three of them. You've lost them, right? They turn around, they start looking at their shoes, and they walk off and get another drink. We need something that's a little more crisp, clear, and useful, I think. AECT, now here come the big dogs. Now, this actually predates the one I just gave you, Pals and Plomp, but educational technology being defined by the professional organization in the United States, and they're an international organization, heavily American, but they do fancy themselves an international organization, and they do accommodate people all over the world, and they have supported people all over the world. That's not a put down of them at all. But we have a Canadian organization as well. But their definition of this in 1977 was educational technology. This is the Association for Educational Communications and Technology. Educational technology is a complex, integrated process involving people, procedures, ideas, devices, and organization for analyzing problems, again, there's the problematic again, and devising, implementing, evaluating, and managing solutions. So they said you've got the problematic, and then you've got the solution orientation to those problems involved in all aspects of human learning. So they really tried to wrap their arms around in a very large way that the whole idea of we have problems, we have solutions, and we have people. And all three of those things, we're going to try and wrap our arms around them. Well, you can imagine that's a pretty big definition. Not a bad one. I mean, they struggled with that for quite a long time before they came up with it. But they went through a couple of other definitions along the way, and then I'll just arrive at what is really still their most recent one. And in 2008, they came up with a special task force, people arguing. You can imagine, you can picture people arm wrestling over tables and things like that about this. But they'd really danced around a lot of terminology in between. They were worried about educational versus instructional, and should we be leaning one way or another. But they finally came to educational technology is the study and ethical practice. That's new. Of facilitating learning and improving performance by creating, using, and managing appropriate technological processes and resources. Now think about that for a second. Ethical practice. Now I kind of like that. Now this is a professional organization coming forward, and we hadn't, up to that point that I know of anyway, we hadn't really staked a claim to ethical practice. Now, you may wonder why that's important, but think about it. The Hippocratic Oath in medicine is the foundational piece, isn't it? There, and we've even adopted in instructional design a portion of their own oath, in that one of our most ethical principles in instructional design is first, do no harm. That's the same thing in medicine. Okay, a good idea is a good idea. It applies a lot of different places. But that whole notion of ethical practice coming along, very important there. And then the whole idea of creating, using, and managing appropriate technological processes. Now, Ivor Davies would come along and say, wait a second, you forgot evaluating. But I think that's assumed in what they wanted here. Yeah, I don't see it explicitly in their definition, but I guess we can live with it. Now, that very definition, and I'm looking at the Encyclopedia of Terminology now, that came out in 2014, Rita Ritchie, and still referring to AECT's 2008 definition as the most current definition. So I wouldn't be surprised that we would see newer definitions coming along now. There are a lot of definitions with... there's a lot of pressure, of course, to acknowledge the social and the social aspect of learning and the informal aspects of learning that are driving much of what we're seeing now. And we'll see what happens with that in the future. In the meantime, let's back up again now, back and forth. This is a little flashback to Gentry, who came along and said, you know, when we're talking about educational technology, we're talking about the systemic and systematic application of behavior and physical science concepts and other knowledge to solutions of problems. Again, the problematic. But by systemic, he meant everything in a system or an environment has an impact on other things in an environment, right? When you have a large system at work, think of the education system. It's probably one of the most awesome systems there are out there. It's complex, it's integrated, it's webbed, it's a spider web of issues. You touch one thing and it moves the spider web a long way away and can have ripple effects throughout the system. So we see ourselves as part of that systemic application. When we move technology in, it affects all kinds of things, doesn't it? But it's also, Gentry emphasized the systematic application, and that it has to be diligent and procedural. Now, do we agree with that? In order to not miss significant variables in a complex learning system. Now, I want you to think about those things, because they drove what we did for a long, long time, and especially that whole notion of being systematic. I graduated from a program that was called Instructional Systems Technology. Okay? It was really educational technology, but people were still struggling with names for things. It still exists as a program, still a wonderful program. It's expanded beyond its own definition, or its own label, I think. But that whole idea of systematic, do we have to be procedural in what we do to be successful? I would argue no, but let's have a look at some of Gentry's assumptions that drive some of the things he has there. One is that he assumes that technology is value-free, that its misuse or its use depends on the values of those who employ it. Kind of the guns don't kill people, people kill people argument, right? He also assumes that the application of technological solutions to one problem may create other, more serious problems. He's also assuming that applications of technology should only be selected after determining whether desirable consequences outweigh undesirable consequences. You don't do anything until you're very, very sure that it's going to be better than what was there before. Do you buy that? And then fear of technology, he assumes, is based on the fear of unknown consequences. And we certainly see that. People are scared to death of technology sometimes just because they don't know what might happen. If I put an online profile out there, will somebody hack into my bank account and rob me blind? You know, you see a lot of those kinds of things. But what I'd ask you to do is think about each of Gentry's assumptions. Think of each of those four assumptions. I think they're very powerful, very clear assumptions. But do they hold water? I would argue that some of his assumptions are stronger than others, that we have more evidence for some of those assumptions than others, and that some of his assumptions might be wedged into an older way of thinking about educational technology that now we're trying to break away from. So I'd like you to think about that critically. By the way, that's a lesson in this class. Think about everything critically. I want you to think deeply about the issues that we confront in this class. And certainly the assumptions driving the use of educational technology, that's big. But I want you to think about one other thing. Our program is educational technology and design. Where is the design hiding in this definition struggle of educational technology? So I'll leave those ideas with you, and we'll talk about them more as the year goes along.